stood up here? Amen. All right. I'd like to welcome you here tonight. We're going to be doing a DVD presentation. We're filming tonight, so I'm on camera, and if any of you stand up and turn around, you'll end up on camera. So what we're going to do is explore this subject of Christmas. I call it Baal Mass, because really that's what it's all about. And I know I'm hated for what I believe regarding this message, but there are those that love the truth, and many people have asked for this. And so we're going to explore this subject tonight as best we can. We wouldn't want to attempt it, though, without first praying and asking for the Lord's help. So shall we join together in prayer? Dear Father in heaven, we are thankful tonight to be able to be here, to have this Bible study together with this visual presentation. And I pray that Thou wouldst be with us and help us, O Lord, that Thou wouldst anoint this message and use it to the glory of Thy name, because we know it is true, for Thy word is true. So, Lord, be with us. Let Satan be driven out. Let him have no power to hinder us in any way. But grant us Thy grace and Thy mercy, and help us, O Lord, to learn and to understand the importance of fleeing from idolatry and walking in all of Thy ways. Guide us and direct us. In Thy precious name we ask it. Let Thy will be done. Let Thy name be exalted. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Now, we are going to look at the subject of Christmas, or as I mentioned before, Baal Mass. It's some people call it Xmas. And others complain about that because they say then you left Christ out of it. I personally think that you should leave him out of idolatry. But anyway, so I have no big problem with them calling it Xmas. I'd rather have them do that than have them call it Christmas. Now, we'll look at words, the meaning of words, traditions, customs, practices, where these things came from, and it should be quite surprising where these things originated. See, many people think this is the greatest time of the year. There's even a song, it's the most wonderful time of the year, you know. And if you go in a store nowadays, I don't like to shop this time of year. If I need something, I'm in and out of there fast, because that music is... And you ever notice what they did? They took the old traditional songs and kind of livened them up or jazzed them, whatever you want to call it. And they're terrible. They got the drums beating and all kinds of weird things going on. But there's a spirit behind this. And even the old traditional songs and practices, if you don't think so, try and take this away from somebody and you've got a fight on your hands. And it's really one day out of the year. Of course, a lot of days lead up to it, and it seems like they put their trees up earlier every year, and all these things are going on. By the time you hit Halloween, which is another witch's Sabbath, they're pretty much ready to go with this one. And there is a spirit in this thing. Remember, every doctrine, every teaching, every doctrine has a spirit. The Bible says that we be henceforth no more children, tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine. That word wind comes from the Greek word pneustos, which is the same word as spirit. So every wind of doctrine, every spirit of doctrine, is a spirit behind every teaching. And if you look at the teachings of Roman Catholicism, or Lutheranism, or Methodism, or any of these isms, they all have spirits behind them. Well, we're going to look at one that seems to weld them all together. We're going to look at a day when everybody becomes Catholic. Now, you can call yourself whatever you want. Lutheran, Methodist, Episcopalian, Presbyterian, whatever you want. This day, people celebrate the Mass of Christ. The Mass, M-A-S-S, from the Latin word masse, in other words, which means, by the way, a death. See, when people say Merry Christmas, a Mass is a death. It has nothing to do with birth. When a priest gets up to say the Mass, and we'll look at these in a little while, some of this happening, actually. When a priest says the Mass, He takes the bread. It's always in a circle, representing the sun god. And he holds it up, and he does his little transubstantiation thing. He says the words, hoc est corpus meum, which means that he's now changing it into the body, the real body of Christ. And from those Latin words, hoc est corpus meum, you get the words hocus pocus. That's really what it is, a bunch of hocus pocus. And he hands out the bread. Did you ever see anybody, or were you ever in a mass where they're handing it out, body of Christ, the body of Christ, the body of Christ, the body of Christ? And then the priest, of course, drinks the wine. And those chalices are pretty good sized. But anyway, so he goes through all of that. And that's what a mass really is. It's a fresh killing of Jesus Christ. That the priest sacrifices, they call it the sacrifice of the mass. The priest sacrifices Jesus Christ over and over and over again every time he does a mass. And if you read in the book of Hebrews, it will tell you that there are those that crucify the Son of God afresh. In other words, over and over and over, when they do that, they put him to an open shame. That Jesus died once for all. One sacrifice. And so when they do this mass, it's a mockery. Now, Christmas actually takes its name from the midnight mass. At midnight on December 24th is when they celebrate it. And if you check out one of these Catholic churches at midnight, I'm getting to be an old man now. I'm 57, so I don't go out much at night. And I'm not going to check this out at midnight. Although I've often wanted to go and just see what they do once. But I don't think I will. I don't know how long I could stand it. But, sit way in the back and pray against it and kind of watch. But the streets will be jammed with people. That's the big day. They have to be there because it is the birthday of something. Is it the birthday of Jesus Christ? No, it isn't. Not according to the Word of God. But it is a birthday. It is a celebration. It has its roots long before Jesus was born. You know, I was in Salem, Massachusetts one time, well, three times actually. And one of the times I was there, I was talking to a witch. Out there they have these occult stores that are the size of supermarkets. They're huge. And I was talking to this witch in there, and she was mad at the Christians. She said, "We hate the Christians because they stole our holidays." Well, she didn't say it that way. She said they stole our Sabbaths and made them into holidays, Christian holidays. She said, "We had them first, and they took them from us and made them into Christian." What an insult to the goddess. See, they... I was talking to one time and asked her a question that startled her, and she said, "Oh, my goddess." It's the way they think. Of course, this woman had fangs. Literally. She had gone to a dentist and had vampire teeth. They were stainless steel canines hanging over her lip. And she was into blood drinking and vampirism and so forth. And of course, December 22nd through the 25th, it's a big time for these people. And they were doing this long before the Catholic Church picked up on it and handed it down to everybody else, and people swallowed it, hook, line, sinker, rod, reel, and boat. Anyway, we're calling this presentation tonight Christmas, the hidden reason for the season. You've probably heard the little cliche people talk and they say, Jesus is the reason for the season. I don't think so. But there is a hidden reason for the season. Now we're going to go through a number of scriptures because we want to lay, this is a foundation that must be laid, a scriptural foundation. You can't go wrong if you get into the Bible and take it exactly for what it says. No footnotes, no twisting of meanings, full context,